Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. And first of all, thank you very much for joining today's I²CNER seminar. I'm Dr. Nakashima at the Department of Applied Chemistry, and happy to chair this special lecture. Today, we have very special speaker, guest from Tokyo University, Professor Kazuhito Hashimoto. I hope you, he is very famous professor, so I hope you know him very well. So maybe no introduction is required, but very, very briefly. He graduated Tokyo University long time ago, maybe. And now he's a full professor, and he got many awards, as you see in this copy. And briefly, he's he got many awards, and he as you see here in this copy, and he's now a member of Science Council of Japan, and his current research interest involves photo-related materials such as photocatalysis, polymer photovoltaic cells, and microbial solar cells. Maybe you know well. So the title of his topic is a photocatalyst and artificial photosynthesis. Professor Hashimoto, please.
Thank you very much for kind introduction and invitation to this special seminar. I'm Hashimoto, and good afternoon, everyone. So I'm very happy to have a chance to give a talk to you. And as I was introduced now, we are working in various fields, but all were related to the energy or environment. And when I was invited to this seminar, I didn't know what I should to talk, because I don't know the interest of the audiences, because you came from various fields, all were related to energy, I understand. But your background are rather scattered. So I really, still I'm wondering what I should do. But anyway, I decided to talk the one of the main topic I have studied for a long time. And that is the, okay. So today, I'm going to talk on the photocatalysis, but my talk will consist of two parts. The one photocatalyst is developed aiming for the environmental applications, which is not directly related to the energy issue, but somehow it is related. And the second one is the photocatalysis for the artificial photosynthesis. This is actually strongly related to your interest, maybe. And both the reaction, the keywords of the both reaction are the same. That is, the multiple electron transfer catalyst. So today, I want to emphasize the importance of the development of multiple electron transfer catalyst. This is the main topic of my today. So let me start to explain briefly about the photocatalysis. The photocatalysis can be divided, roughly divided into two categories, depending on the existence of oxygen. When the reaction is done in the presence of oxygen, usually oxygen serves as the electron acceptor. And the reaction, this is a typical reaction, the various organic compounds react with oxygen, in other words, it is oxidized, finally into CO2. And the Gibbs free energy of those reactions are negative. The other one, the reactions in the absence of oxygen. Okay, the typical reaction is water decomposition into hydrogen and oxygen. Okay, this is called artificial photosynthesis. Most of you may know this. And this reaction, Gibbs free energy of this reaction is positive. Energy capture reaction. Okay. So first, I'm going to talk on the first topic, the reaction in the presence of oxygen, Gibbs free energy negative Gibbs free energy change. The photocatalytic reactions in the presence of oxygen, the most famous, and which I have studied for a long time, is the reaction using titanium dioxide, famous titanium dioxide. Titanium dioxide is a white pigment, and that's why it absorbs only UV light. It absorbs only UV light. But the characteristics of this, the titanium dioxide, is this deep valence band. In other words, photogenerated hole has a strong oxidation power. That's why it can oxidize various, for example, organic compound, finally into CO2. So the such oxidation power of photogenerated hole is so strong, much stronger than even the ozones. That's why all the elements are essentially developed to oxidize into its final oxidation valence. So by using such strong oxidation power, those reactions are studied toward environmental technologies such as water purification or air purification or soil treatment, et cetera, which I also studied. And there are so many people studied for those reactions using titanium dioxide, even in this campus, for a long time. But although those are studied for a long time, actual application is so difficult still now on. But about 20 years ago, I got the idea to apply the photocatalytic reaction to the building materials. The difference is, okay, the idea is to coat the various building materials with this photocatalysis. The reaction field is two-dimensional surface. So reactant concentration is very low because those are the surface reactions. That's why what I thought is even the light is weak, we can expect some effect for these materials. Actually, so early 90s, I got this idea in the toilet. And I really got this idea when the toilet is coated with our titanium dioxide, the bacteria on the toilet will be killed or something like that. That's why I called to Toto. Toto is a scientific company situated here, around here, in Kyushu city. And then we started the collaboration with Toto. That's why the first application of photocatalysis was done by Toto company in the toilet, application to the toilet. Anyway, that side story. Anyway, so titanium dioxide has such a strong oxidation power, that's why various organic compounds such as the dust or bacteria are oxidized finally into CO2. And those are the reactions on the two-dimensional surface, because this is the titanium dioxide coated materials. Cleaning of such materials is easily done even if the light intensity is not so strong. Even under the rather weak UV light intensity, it works. Self-cleaning function or antibacterial function, something like that. Okay, those are such very simple applications which I got the image. But during those experiments, I was very lucky that we found very new phenomenon on the surface of titanium dioxide. That is, when such a coating material is illuminated by UV light, surface becomes so hydrophilic. And such a hydrophilic property is maintained for 10 hours or something like that, even if the light is off. So we name it, photo-induced hydrophilicity. Actually, the water contact angle of this photo-illuminated titanium dioxide surface becomes nearly 0 degrees. So very hydrophilic like that. And scientifically, this is the new findings, and still now many people are working on the mechanism of this, including me. But the more important one is this phenomenon is really powerful to the application. That is, the titanium dioxide coated material shows very clear self-cleaning effect and anti-fogging effect because the surface becomes so hydrophilic, that's why the rainwater washes out the nodular materials on the surface, something like that. And I don't tell the details of this today, but this one is actually, okay, this is one of the examples. Left-hand part is coated with our materials, and this glass is coated, this part is coated with our materials, something like that. This is a PET film coated with titanium dioxide. This is the original pristine PET film. You know, the self-cleaning effect based on the photo-induced decomposition reactions and photo-induced hydrophilic convergence. And because the surface becomes so hydrophilic, that's why the mirror does not fog. And such an anti-fogging mirror is used more than 50% of the Toyota car produced recently, something like that. And those are really applied now in industry, and our materials are used all over the world like that. And Tokyo and the football stadium in Dallas, or pyramid in front of the Louvre Museum in Paris, or cricket stadium in Dubai, or something like that, all over the world. I'm really happy. Okay, it's okay. This is old story. And the so far, we used UV light. And those materials I introduced were used only outdoors because sunlight has small amount of UV light, but that UV light is enough for the application of two-dimensional surface reactions. But when we apply our materials to indoor materials, the UV light intensity of indoor is three orders of magnitude weaker than the outdoors. That's why it's not enough. So that's why for indoor applications, we have to develop the new materials which absorbs the visible light, not the UV light. OK, this is the first topic. So our challenge is to develop the titanium dioxide-based visible light-sensitive materials. Okay, this is the schematic picture, schematic energies of titanium dioxide energy diagram, picture of the energy diagram. Our first challenge is to design the visible light-sensitive titanium dioxide. This is the conduction band. This is valence band. Band gap is about three electron volts. That's why it can absorb only UV light. And the bottom conduction band bottom determines its reduction power. And valence band top determines its oxidation power. You know, because light illumination creates electron and holes. And this electron is transferred to something. In other words, it reduces something on the surface of surface species. And photoproduced hole is transferred to the surface, oxidized the surface of soft species. That's why the reduction power of photocatalyst is determined by the conduction band edge. And oxidation power of photocatalyst is determined by the valence band edge. Okay, it's okay, very clear. So, to have the visible light sensitive materials, we have to lower the conduction band, either raise the valence band. It's very clear. It's very clear. To have the visible light sensitive materials, we have to lower the conduction band or raise the valence band. Okay. One of the most famous the visible light sensitive titanium dioxide is nitrogen doped titanium dioxide. It's not developed by us. This was first reported by Toyota Research Center Group about 10 years ago, and they showed Okay, this is the first principle calculations. This is the conduction band of titanium dioxide, and this is the valence band of titanium dioxide. Okay. When we dope nitrogen, the 2p orbital of nitrogen is situated just above the valence band top. Actually, the valence band of titanium dioxide mainly consists of 2p orbital of oxygen atom. And the nitrogen, 2p orbital of nitrogen is situated just above the valence band top. Okay. And when we increase the concentration of nitrogen, then this becomes broader and mixed with valence band, and then the valence band narrowing occurs. Conduction band is not affected by the introduction of nitrogen at all. Okay. Actually, when we dope the titanium dioxide, okay, from now on, I show the photocatalytic ability by the decomposition reaction of 2-propanol. Okay, 2-propanol, you know, all of you know 2-propanol. And when the 2-propanol is oxidized, it is finally oxidized into three CO2 molecules by acetone. If our photocatalyst has the strong ability means the strong oxidation power, then the isopropanol, one molecule of isopropanol produces three mole of CO2 by acetone. Okay. So what happens when we use this titanium dioxide? Actually, as I told, titanium dioxide is a white pigment, but when we dope nitrogen, it colors yellow. Okay. Because it starts absorb around 400 or 420 nanometer or something like that. Actually, when we try the decomposition of 2-propanol by using this nitrogen-doped titanium dioxide, we observed CO2. And first we observe acetone, and then finally acetone is oxidized into CO2. It works. It works. Actually, this visible light sensitive photocatalyst works. However, when we illuminate with UV light instead of visible light, and control the absorption photon number is equivalent. Okay. Then the reaction starts like that. It means, okay, in this case, the difference is the photon numbers are the same. Absorbed photon numbers are the same. So that means actually the photocatalyst works well. However, the reaction activity is much higher with UV light than the visible light. Why? It's very, very simple. Very simple. As I told, the nitrogen doping causes the band here. That's why when we increase the concentration of nitrogen, the valence band is raised. So this material can absorb the visible light. Band gap narrowing is achieved. However, in this case, you know that the band gap, valence band top is raised up. It means the oxidation power decreased. Oxidation power decreased. So that's why the reactivity decreases. As I told, that the valence band top determines the oxidation power. And what we did is raise the valence band top, so reaction activity decreased. That's very clear. Okay, the most important point of photocatalyst is the strong oxidation power. That's why we do not want to lose the oxidation power. So what we should do? What we should do is, instead of raise the valence band, we should lower the conduction band. That's very simple again. So when we lower the conduction band, the photo-produced oxygen, photo-produced hole does not lose its oxidation power. So it may keep the strong oxidation power. That's very logically true. So we try to develop such a material. Then again, we did the first calculation, first principle calculation. And what we know is when we dope tungsten to titanium dioxide, gallium is the introduced only to maintain the charge balance. So important one is tungsten. When we introduce tungsten, and this is the calculation of titanium dioxide. This is conduction band, and this is valence band. When we introduce tungsten into the titanium dioxide, then the 5D orbital, no, 5D orbital of the tungsten is located just below the conduction band top, bottom. Okay. So by this one is the, from the tungsten. So it means that when we introduce the tungsten, it starts absorbed visible light. Actually, this is a sample. When we introduce tungsten into titanium dioxide, then the absorption edge shifted to red side direction. So this is because, as I told, the tungsten's the orbital is mixed with conduction band. And important one is that the valence band is not affected by the doping of tungsten. Okay. So we have the photocatalyst which can absorb the visible light, but the photogenerated hole can maintain its strong oxidation power. What happens? We try the photocatalytic reaction, photocatalytic decomposition of two propanol again. And this is the result, almost no reactions. No reactions. It absorbs the visible light, and it could maintain the strong oxidation power. However, no reaction at all. The reason is very clear. This is the energy structure of titanium dioxide. This is the conduction band bottom, and this is valence band. This is pristine titanium dioxide. That's why the band gap of 3.2 eV. And this excited electron, this reaction is done in the presence of oxygen, as I told. Okay. So this excited electron is transferred to oxygen from the O2 minus and the HO2 radical. This is the reaction of this system. And the important one is redox potential, standard redox potential of this oxygen reduction. This redox potential is situated just below the conduction band bottom of titanium dioxide. That's why when we lower the conduction band, then the excited electron cannot be transferred to oxygen anymore. That's why even if we created the holes with strong oxidation power, reaction does not proceed. That's very clear. Very clear. So the question is how we can consume this electron, excited electron. This is our question. But it's impossible to transfer to oxygen from this redox thermodynamically. However, this redox potential, we have to pay attention to this redox potential. This redox potential is a redox reaction with one electron transfer reaction. When we consider the two electron reactions, then the oxygen produces hydrogen peroxide. Or when we consider the four electron transfers, oxygen is transferred to water. And those redox potentials are situated much lower, much more positive than one electron transfer process. That's why if we can induce such a two electron transfer reactions or four electron transfer reactions, this excited electron can be easily consumed. So what we have to do is to develop, to induce such a two electron transfer or four electron transfer reactions. For such a purpose, we need multiple electron transfer catalyst. This is a point, this is a very important point. And what we can understand is the surface of titanium dioxide does not have the catalytic activity for multiple electron transfer process. Only one electron transfer proceeds on the surface of titanium dioxide. That's why we have to develop some catalyst which is used for the multiple electron transfer, either two electron transfer or four electron transfer processes. This is really important. And what's going on, how we can design such a multiple electron transfer catalyst, it's a question. Then we don't know. That's why we should learn from nature in the natural system. In natural system, there exists famous multi-electron oxygen reduction catalyst in enzyme. That is the multi-copper oxidase. This is well known to reduce oxygen in the four electron transfer processes. Oxygen is reduced to water in this the enzyme with four electron transfer processes. And this enzyme is consists of four copper ions. Four copper ions. Okay. And four copper ions, initially it's all copper ions are cupric ion, so four cupric ions, and four electrons are, important one, okay. And each copper accepts one electron. That's why four electrons are stored in this enzyme. And these four electrons are transferred to oxygen. Hmm? Let me see. I forgot which one. Anyway, very important one is the four electrons. Each copper accepts one electron. That's why four electrons are stored in this enzyme. And these four electrons are simultaneously transferred to oxygen. That's why this one serves as the four electron transfer catalyst. Okay. So copper has such a power, and nature teaches us copper has such a power. And nature has such a so sophisticated system. So how we can learn from the nature? I'm not such a sophisticated person. That's why what we did is very simple. We try to modify the surface of titanium dioxide with cupric ion. Very simple. Not sophisticated at all. What we did is they mixed the titanium dioxide powder with cupric chloride and dried it up at 110 degrees. When we see the surface by TEM, PIC-TEM, transmission electron micrograph, then we know that the cluster with a size of 2 nanometers are formed on the surface. This could be cupric oxide or something like that. Okay, so nanocluster of cupric compound. Such very simple the preparation, and we did the experiment. This is the result. This is the one which I showed previously, and those are the data. This is CO2 production by acetone. When the surface of this the tungsten doped titanium dioxide is modified with cupric ion, okay, cupric ion grafted titanium dioxide, then it absorbs the absorbed visible light efficiently induced the photocatalytic reaction, and this 2-propanol is finally or efficiently oxidized into CO2. Okay, it means that it suggests that this cupric nanocluster serves as the two or four electron transfer oxidation reduction catalyst. I do not tell the details, but we have done various analysis of these materials by the X-ray absorption spectroscopy, and what we found is that the surface of this 2 to 3 nanometer the species materials are cupric oxide mixture of cupric oxide and hydroxide, and this is amorphous structure. So actually, such a schematic picture is correct. And this the this nanocluster serves as the induced two electron transfer reduction, two electron reduction reaction of oxygen. In other words, this serves as the multiple two electron transfer catalyst for this reaction. We don't know why it works so well, but anyway, this such a very simple simple modification of the surface, or such a very simple nanocluster, serves as the two electron transfer catalyst. I don't tell the details so much, but I show one of the other example. We know that when we dope titanium 3 into titanium, in other words, when the titanium is reduced, partially reduced, it starts the coloring, like yellow colors. And this is known that the surface, not the surface, but in the bulk, titanium 3 is produced. And when that, the titanium dioxide is partially reduced and to form the titanium 3 in the bulk of titanium dioxide, we know that it starts the absorption in this visible light region. But we know that this one, this transition as the excitation of valence band hole to this titanium 3 plus. We know this one. However, we also know that this excited electron does not have the reaction power, because this state serves as the recombination center of excited electron and holes. That's why those materials are known for a long time, but we knew that this material is not effective for photocatalytic reaction. However, this is a reaction with reaction of the two propanol decomposition oxidation with this titanium 3 doped titanium dioxide, no reaction. However, when we modify the surface of this titanium 3 doped titanium dioxide with cupric materials, cupric nanomaterials, then again it shows so effective, it turned to so effective visible light sensitive materials. And this is explained similarly. Excited electron is effectively transferred to the surface to the cupric oxide, hydroxide nanoclusters. And it serves as a good reduction, two electron reduction of oxygen. So it works. Anyway, based on those findings, we developed various photocatalysts which works under the visible light, under room light. And those have the very strong photocatalytic reaction and shows very strong antibacterial and antivirus functions too. So we collaborated with various companies and developed not only the powders, but the coating salts or films or ceramic tiles. And those are now tested in the field, the university hospitals and the airport. This is the Chitose Airport. And the second floor, departure floor of Chitose Airport, at the departure floor of Chitose Airport, we are doing such a demonstration test. So when you go to Hokkaido University, you will be tested by a sample. And it's going now. We have very good many data, but I show only one example. This is a washroom in a hospital toilet. And the number of bacteria. This is the existing toilet. And this one is renovated. Renovated means that the surface is coated with our paint and titanium dioxide. That's all. And then the surface is coated our material, then the number of bacteria decreased drastically like that. More than 90% of bacteria killed in this toilet, something like that. It's so effective. And we continue the demonstration test until the end of this year. And many companies are very much interested in the, for the the production of this material, and I hope that that will be commercialized in the near future. Anyway, it's a different story. The important point, what I want to summarize, want to say now is that cupric, and I didn't tell today, but the ferric oxide, hydroxide, also have the similar the property, that is the ferric hydroxide, oxide, amorphous nanoparticle serves as the two electron oxygen reduction catalyst. So when that surface is modified with cupric or ferric oxide, hydroxide nanoclusters, amorphous nanoclusters, that's very important. That should be amorphous nanoclusters. Then it works as the multiple electron transfer catalyst. And today I didn't tell the details, but not only such a direct excitation, but this material has the another absorption, that is the photoexcitation of the valence band electron to the surface modified species. That is called the interfacial charge transfer process. I didn't tell the details, so it's okay. Forget about it. But based on those two photoexcitation process, those materials are so so effective. But important point here I want to emphasize is the reason why we can develop this efficient, novel efficient blue light photocatalyst is because we succeeded to find this new two electron oxidation reaction catalyst by this by such a very simple process. Okay, so the second topic. Now, so far I showed that the multiple electron transfer catalyst, especially for the oxygen reduction, two electron oxygen reduction catalyst is really important for the development of the visible light photocatalyst. And the second topic is the photocatalyst catalytic reactions in the absence of oxygen. And today my talk will be focused on this water decomposition. Everyone knows. This is a four electron transfer process. Okay. Give free energy, positive gives free energy. Okay, so this reaction, the very famous one is the photocatalysis using the gallium nitride doped zinc oxide, reported by Professor Dorman, my good friend in our university. He, a few years ago, his group found that the gallium nitride and zinc oxide, gallium nitride is doped to zinc oxide. Then they have the visible light sensitive materials. And when this surface is modified with rhodium chromium materials, it serves as a good hydrogen production catalyst. Then they have succeeded to have the hydrogen and the oxygen. This is really good work. Yes. The other one, and recently the people are very much interested in as the work reported by Nozera. They reported that when that the silicon photocell is modified with the catalyst, which they produce cobalt-based catalyst. It works as a good the oxygen production catalyst, and the other surface is modified with hydrogen production catalyst. Then they have such a wireless photoelectrochemical device. In one side they can produce oxygen, the other side they can produce hydrogen. So this attracts many people's attention. I heard that they built a venture company based on this technology. However, we have to recognize that, the Dorman's catalyst, it absorbs the visible light because band gap is 2.5 to 2.8 electron volt. It absorbs visible light. But they need, in other words, they need 2.5 or at least 2.5 electron volt to induce the water cleavage reaction. How about for Nozera's case? They use silicon device, photocells. However, when it shows in a small character, they use three junctions of silicon photocells. Three junctions, cheese. So it means that they need 3 volts to decompose the water. It's really strange, you know, that the Gibbs free energy change of the hydrogen and oxygen production is only 1.23 electron volt. That's why thermodynamically we expect that this reaction can be induced with the semiconductor with a band gap of 1.5 electron volt or something like that. But in reality, they need more than 2.5 electron volt or 3 volt. Why? Why? The reason is this gives free energy of 1.3 electron volt for this water decomposition is based on this half reactions. One half reaction is hydrogen production. The other one is oxygen production. And by combining those reactions, we need only 1.3 electron volt. Okay. So this oxidation reaction is 4 electron transfer process. If we combine with this process, with this oxidation process, we need 1.8 electron volt. This is if that reaction proceeds, 2 electron transfer process. Or if the oxidation of water proceeds 1 electron process step by step. Okay, if the 4 electron transfer reaction proceed step by step with 1 electron transfer process, then we need more than 2.5 electron volt. Okay, this is the reason. Nobody said like that, but I believe the reason why that those photocatalysts or nozzles process need such a large overpotential is the surface of their system is not good for the oxidation production. And probably such a 1 electron transfer process is the rate determinant step. So that's why they need such a large voltage. In other words, for the artificial photosynthesis, we have to develop this 4 electron transfer oxidation catalyst, water oxidation catalyst. This is very, very essential point, I believe. Nobody says something like that, but I'm quite confident this is true. What's going on in the nature? What's going on in nature? Everybody knows, here everybody knows. In a photosynthetic system, the three very important parts, the light harvesting part and the reduction part and oxidation parts are well decorated. Such a sophisticated system is well ordered. And the oxidation center is so-called photosystem too, that is consists of tetramanganese cluster, 4 manganese ions cluster. And this importance is well known, and so far many, many people are interested in this process and this photosystem too. And so many works are reported. And this manganese 4 cluster in photosystem 2 is so-called Koch cycle. And we know that each manganese absorbs, in this process, 4 photons. 4 photons are simultaneously absorbed by these clusters. However, the electron transfer occurs, 4 electron transfer occurs simultaneously. So each photon stores 1 electron in this cluster. That's why after 4 photons absorption, 4 electrons are stored. No, sorry, 4 holes. 4 holes are stored in this cluster. Then that hole, 4 holes are transferred simultaneously to water producing oxygen. Okay, so key point is that this 4 manganese cluster can store 1 hole each by 1 photon, something like that. That's why the structure of this photosystem to enzyme is one of the big topics. And some of you may know that the very famous work was reported last year by the Japanese group, the Kamiya and the Chen group. They determined the structure of photosystem 2 precisely by using spring 8. And they reported that work, the precise structure of photosystem 2 in Nature, and that work is selected as one of the top 10 breakthroughs of the year of last year, 2011, by Science, Journal of Science. And what they said, what they reported is simply the structure of this photosystem 2 enzyme. However, what they said is this structure isn't just essential for life. It may also hold the key to a source of clean energy. And knowing the structure of nature's catalyst may help scientists to design better synthetic ones. Okay, so they reported precise structure of this tetramanganese cluster. And they expect that by knowing the structure, this structure by scientists, us, we, may have the idea to design the better synthetic oxygen producer, water oxidation catalyst. I don't have. I cannot get any image by knowing this. But however, those are so important topic. And actually, the oxygen evolution using synthetic manganese 4 clusters are reported by many, many scientists for, and so far over 100 structures of tetranuclear manganese oxo complex have been reported. However, something that nobody can succeed it. Those are not efficient at all for the 4-electron transfer process. One more point I want to say that, very interesting report we found that they said a possible evolutionary origin of the tetramanganese cluster of the photosynthetic water oxidation complex, photosystem 2, may derive from the natural manganese oxide precipitate in the early ocean. What they said is, in nature, the photosystem 2 contains tetramanganese clusters. The origin of that tetramanganese cluster may be the natural manganese oxide precipitate in the early ocean from the ground. Actually, we found various tetranuclear structure and minerals like that. Okay, so they suggested that the origin of photosystem 2 is from one of those minerals, something like that, in early stage. However, and those are the background, and this is a long-standing question. There is a remarkable contradiction between the extraordinary catalytic performance of the photosynthetic manganese center. Okay, natural system is so efficient for the 4-electron transfer process of oxygen, of water. However, very poor or non-existing catalytic activity of synthetic manganese compounds. And such a catalytic activity is usually shown by the electrode potential. Okay, the catalytic property of those catalysts is measured by measuring the oxygen production current, water oxidation current by electrochemical system. And this, assume this is the standard redox potential. And if the catalytic property is good, in other words, if that catalyst serves as the 4-electron transfer process, then the anodic current, oxidation production current in AK solution starts something like this. However, the synthetic manganese catalyst, when the electrode is modified with synthetic manganese catalyst, then the oxidation production current starts very positive potential. Those large overpotential is the measure of the, this overpotential is the measure of the catalytic property of the system, of those system. And what he suggested, Professor Toribuchi, he's a good friend of mine, he's a genius person, and what he suggested is natural system In a natural system, the current, oxidation current, start near the standard redox potential of 4-electron process. However, synthetic one has large overpotential. Okay, we do not know the reason. Okay, so we synthesized the manganese oxide and electrode and did such an experiment. And actually, the oxidation current started 1.6 volt at pH 6. The standard redox potential of this system at pH 6 should be something like that. So if that catalyst works as a good four-electron oxidation catalyst, current should start like this one. However, actually, it has a large overpotential of 600 millivolts, so large overpotential. It means that this manganese oxide does not work well. Okay. This is the oxidation current, and this red circle means the oxygen, produced oxygen, amount of oxygen produced. Okay, so our challenge from now on is to obtain the excellent manganese oxide-based oxygen production catalyst. From now on, this is a challenge. How we should do? Those are known very well. And in the natural system, it has very good system. However, the synthetic one does not show such a good behavior. So I do not have the details. So I do not have time to explain the details. So I showed briefly what we did. What we did is in situ UV visible light absorption measurement, and what we found is during those electrochemical experiment, the new peak appears around 500 nanometers. And this is a differential spectra during the electrolysis. And by applying the potential to positively, then new peak appears 510 nanometers. I don't tell the details, but anyway, very important one is, this newly appeared species which has absorption around 500 nanometers, could be a precursor of oxygen production. Those are things which we knew. I have to stop now. Okay. So I don't tell the details. Anyway, very important one is we found this species, this newly developed species, this is a precursor of oxygen production, can be assigned to the surface-associated manganese 3+. And sorry, it takes, we need the time to explain the details. And, let me see. We have done various experiments, and what we recognized, what we found is the manganese 3+, the first step is manganese 3+ formation, but this manganese 3+ cannot be stabilized in this system. So, from now on, give me 5 more minutes. Okay, so to have the good oxidation production catalyst, what we have to do is to stabilize manganese 3+. This is the key point. And the reason that manganese 3+ cannot be existing is manganese 3+ is unstable at neutral condition due to the potential inversion process. It means that the oxidation potential of manganese 3 is more positive than the oxidation potential of more negative than the oxidation potential of manganese 2. That's why manganese 3+ cannot exist by the disproportionation reactions. It's really complicated. That's why I need the time to explain. So sorry, I have no time to explain this one. But very important, what I want to say is like that. Okay, by knowing such a analytical work, we got the design strategy. Design strategy for the efficient oxygen production catalyst, that is to stabilize the Mn-3+. And to stabilize the Mn-3+, we got the hypothesis to decrease the symmetry of ligand field of manganese is a key factor. And such a hypothesis we got. So we try to decrease the symmetry of manganese oxide, and we try to modify the surface of manganese oxide with nitrogen. Then, because manganese oxide, the manganese is coordinated with oxygen with high symmetry. And so if we introduce nitrogen to coordinate manganese, then we can decrease the symmetry. That's a very simple system. And this one, okay. So I cannot explain it. Only conclusion I showed. This is the one which I showed. This is oxygen production reactions versus potentials. And this is a pristine manganese oxide. And oxygen production occurs at very negative potential, although the standard redox potential is situated here. And this is the anodic current. This is because the manganese oxide catalytic activity is not good. That's why we had such a large overpotential. And the origin of the reason of this large overpotential is due to the instability of Mn-3+. And the reason of the Mn-3+ stability is high symmetric structure of manganese oxide. That's the point I didn't explain. So by knowing that, we try to modify the surface of manganese oxide by nitrogen to decrease the symmetry. Then we synthesize such a one and measure the oxygen production reaction. What we did is like that. I'm sorry, I have no time to explain it. But by simply modify the surface of manganese oxide with nitrogen, then oxygen production starts at this potential. At this potential means this potential is almost equal to the standard redox potential of 4-electron oxidation process, 4-oxidation water redox potential. It means it has no overpotential. And manganese oxide turned to so efficient 4-electron transfer catalyst. The reason is, let me summarize again. The reason manganese oxide cannot be the good oxygen production catalyst is the instability of Mn-3+, which we found by spectroscopic experiment. And that the instability of Mn-3+ is explained by the high symmetric structure of manganese oxide. So by knowing that, we assumed by decreasing the symmetry of manganese oxide, then we could have highly efficient catalyst, 4-electron oxidation catalyst. So we synthesized, or very simply modified the surface of manganese oxide with nitrogen to lower the symmetry. Then actually, the oxygen production starts as a potential nearly equal to the standard redox potential. So it clearly shows our the synthesized one has very, very highly efficient oxygen production catalyst, 4-electron transfer oxygen production catalyst. So it's better to understand initially why I saw that manganese tetracluster can stores four holes. When we see the balance of those manganese, then actually manganese 3 can exist in this enzyme. As I told, manganese 3 cannot be stabilized in neutral region. However, this the free manganese 3 ion cannot stay in neutral region. However, in natural system enzyme, manganese 3 can stay stably even in pH 3 solution. And I saw that the last year's report in Nature by Japanese group, they found the structure of photosystem 2, precise structure of manganese tetraclusters. And what they show is this manganese 4 cluster shows the distorted chair structures and asymmetric coordination structures. Both lower the symmetry of manganese clusters. Actually, what we did, what we succeed for the, to have the good oxidation production catalyst is to lower the symmetry of manganese clusters. And actually, Nature, by knowing the Nature structure, we surprised that, okay, in Nature, actually those manganese cluster has very similar structure with us. I mean that the symmetry of the symmetry of manganese cluster is very low. And that's the key point, we believe, to stabilize manganese 3 plus. And that's a key point that those system works very good four electron transfer, four electron transfer catalyst for oxygen production. Okay, so the important point from now on, this is the ongoing project. We found that the nitrogen-coordinated manganese oxide serves as a good four electron transfer oxygen production catalyst. That's why if we modify this Nozera's wireless electrochemical cell with our newly developed catalyst, although they use three junctions of photocells, but I believe, I'm quite confident that this device can be driven only two junctions of two volt is enough, because the thermodynamically 1.23 electron volt is enough to induce. And when the Dohmann's catalyst is modified with our catalyst, they can decrease, they can use much low band gap, small band gap catalyst. So those, the reason what I believe is that, you know, the multiple electron transfer process decrease the potentials. So for such an energy conversion system, development of multiple transfer electron catalyst is really essential. Okay, I'm very sorry that I took too much time for the initial topic for the photocatalytic reaction in the presence of oxygen that is used for the environmental purification. And the second topic, I showed that photocatalysis in the absence of oxygen for the artificial photosynthesis. And the first topic, I showed that the cupric and the ferric oxide hydroxide serves as the two electron transfer oxygen reduction catalyst. And the second topic, I'm sorry I didn't have a time, that the nitrogen coordinated manganese oxide serves as a good four electron oxidation catalyst. And to manage multiple electron, the chemistry is one of the most important keys, I think, for the energy conversion and the environmental process. And those works are done with my colleagues, and they financially supported for the first topic by NEDO and the second topic of JSTLAT project. Thank you for your attention. And I'm very sorry, I couldn't explain the details of the second topic. I'm very sorry for that.